Don't have a quorum again. I think we're going to have to move this committee back to like 8:15, 8:30. Oh,
yeah. Mm-hmm. All right.
Whatever you want, Mr.
We're going to start with the presentation for House File 1. We have a number of amendments, and there's some changes. So that every amendment will have to make and some other stuff. So we're going to be going to staff to explain it on these amendments and other stuff that's been done to make sure that it's all in good shape and can be fixed. And then we're going to make sure we put in some place into both these bills that allows staff to make the appropriate changes as needed. Something along those lines. Somebody's got something I'm supposed to read. So with that, Representative Pento, Representative Codine, please present, if you would be so kind.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'll begin just to hand things to Representative Kotyza-Witthuhn. So, members, House File 1 is a product of the work for the Early Childhood Division that builds up a lot of our work over the last year or so and is aimed at our two crises and opportunity gaps in our state and the child care. The crisis in child care access and affordability, I think members are very aware of. I'm going to turn things over to the author of the bill, Representative Kotyza-Witthuhn, to just provide a bit of background, and then I'll be ready for amendments, for our testifiers' amendments, et cetera.
Good morning, and thank you, Mr. Chair. Members, advocates, parents, and caregivers, I know many of you have heard the opportunity, or had the opportunity to hear pieces of House File 1 in other committees, so I'm going to keep a little bit shorter this morning. I know we're on a timeline as well, but I am excited to be here today to discuss the new and improved Great Start for All Minnesota Children Act. House File 1 is a bold set of investments to support our youngest Minnesotans and their families by addressing both the persistent opportunity gap and the nationwide child care crisis. In the Early Childhood Division last year, we've heard frequently how the first few years of a child's life, prenatal through pre-K, truly impact the rest of the child's life. In House File 1, we highlight some of the critical investments and initiatives to stem the opportunity gap here in Minnesota by increasing home visiting opportunities, investing in both scholarships and child care assistance to help families cover the cost of child care, and supporting child care providers by increasing rates, providing grants for potential improvements in delivery, and offering the opportunity for ongoing process improvement. We know that there are thousands more children and families that we can help. So this year, we're doing all that we can to meet Minnesota families where they are right now. Children are only young once, and now is the time to invest in them. This is a down payment on the future of our state. Our kids can't wait, and their future begins today. It's clearer now than ever the economics of child care don't work. You and this committee know that truthfully and very well. When we listen to parents and caregivers, we hear that there isn't a one-size-fits-all delivery model that works for every family, and there are improvements that we can make in regulatory reform to better support all types of providers. So in order to aid providers in making those potential delivery improvements, we must continue to adjust our own processes, including an evaluation of Parent Aware, to better discern where we may encourage providers to improve delivery and see how we can all be better and better prepare our children for a lifetime of learning. Continuing to invest in this area is crucial.
Go ahead, Representative Pinto. All
right. Thank you, Mr. Chair. If we can have, we have just two testifiers, if we can have Ms. Jost come up first.
Good morning. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name and proceed with your testimony.
Good morning, Mr. Chair and committee members. My name is Nancy Jost. I am the Director of Early Childhood at West Central Initiative, which is based in Fergus Falls. And I'm going to tell you just a little bit about a project that we're doing with the funding that we received last year. And WCI has been focusing on the child care teachers. The shortage of child care teachers is our biggest roadblock in the child care shortage. Child care teachers do not make enough money to choose this as a profession or to stay in it long term. The average wage is around $10 to $12 an hour. This is not a livable wage, nor does it compensate people for what we are asking them to do, which is to help build the brains of our next generation of citizens. Because the childcare workforce cannot afford to get the education they need to do this important job, we are trying to provide as many ways to do this as possible with as little cost to the childcare teacher as possible. We're working on making three options available, and each of these options would give the person the qualifications to be teacher qualified. The first one is that we're helping current childcare center and family-based childcare teachers to get their CDA, which is a Child Development Associate Certificate. And we're doing that to them for them with little or no cost. The second way we're doing this is to recruit high schools to work with Alexandria Technical and Community College, providing early childhood online college courses in the high school. And then third option we are working on is we are working with MDE to provide CDAs, the Child Development Associate, in the high school setting. And our work will start people on their pathway to an early childhood career and help communities with their childcare shortage. With continued funding, we could look at where there are other gaps in supports to childcare teachers and reasons for the lack of childcare and help fill those gaps with the funding. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Jones.
Jim Penny, president of the Southern Minnesota Initiative Foundation. On behalf of the other five rural initiative foundations, I'm here to express support for this legislation, particularly the allocation that would come to the initiative foundations to do early childhood work across all of rural Minnesota. Collectively, our foundations represent all 80 non-metro counties in the state. In the last session, there was an allocation of $120,000 to each of the initiative foundations to do work around community planning regarding child care needs and child care quality. We do this in collaboration with other organizations like First Children's Finance, Child Care Aware, Latino Economic Development Corporation, and others. Collaboration is in our DNA. The trainings that we offer focus on business expertise as well as child care quality, including social and emotional training. For example, in our region in Central Southeastern Minnesota, we're in several communities now offering these training opportunities for child care providers. And this funding also helps us with an annual child care conference, which about 500 providers attend. All of this designed to give them continuing education credits that they need at no cost. And the appropriation in this bill would allow all eight of these initiative foundations to carry forward this work.
Mr. Chair, with your permission, we're ready to move to amendments. There is an author's amendment, the A-17, and several others as well, all done with testifiers.
The A-17 is the author's amendment?
That is correct, Mr. Chair. I believe that there is an oral amendment, simply that it says the second division engrossment, and in fact, it's the first engrossment, I believe. So just need to make that correct.
Covered here, sir. Yeah. I will move the A-17 amendment. And I will move to amend the A-17 amendment. It's on page 1, line 1, delete everything after the, and insert first amendment, comma. First engrossment, comma. So to the amendment. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. We have the amendment in the way that it needs to be. Please present your amendment.
And thank you, Mr. Chair and members. So this is simply an author's amendment that puts the bill in the shape that the author wishes. There's just a few cleanup items, and let me think. Yeah, just several items. I guess we could walk it through if necessary, but it does. It just obviously the bill continues moving along as we go. I guess I'll one thing that I'll just note is that this would require in this committee's jurisdictional area the funding to the First Children's Finance Program to have the same kind of outcomes as the funding going to several other of the programs in the bill, which seems like an appropriate thing to find out what kind of impact are we having, and several others as well.
Are there any questions? Any comments to, would anyone care to testify for or against this? Seeing no questions and no other testifiers, all those in favor of the A-17 amendment signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Next amendment. I have an A-11 amendment here. As a, oh, let's make the A-17 amendment has moved as the A-17 amendment as amended has been approved. Did I get that right? A-11?
It's.
Is anyone going to claim the A-11?
Oh, A-11, yes. I was thinking A. Sorry, Chair. 17 was in my head, so excuse me. Yes, I will claim A-11, Chair.
Would you care to move it?
Yes, I would care to move A-11 amendment as orally amended.
I don't think.
Do we?
For just a moment, I'm going to ask staff to give us some clarification.
Oh, I'm sorry. I move to orally amend A-11 amendment, page 1, line 1, delete everything after the, and insert the first engrossment, comma. That's what I have to be official. Thank you.
We have the A-11 amendment moved. All in favor of the oral amendment to the A-11 amendment signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed? The A-11 has been amended.
Okay, good. Thank you, Chair and members. What this amendment does is it simply allows the commissioner to waiver the requirement that child care grant recipients must have a 50% non-state match in order to receive grant funds. This way, the commissioner can use his discretion to waive this requirement. I feel that it gives more flexibility to help with what we're facing with child care out in the marketplace. If he thinks it's a good project that might not be able to meet the non-state match but still deserves funding, and that's what the A-11 amendment does, Chair and members.
Is there any comments? Representative Pinto.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members. This is a great idea. We really appreciate Representative Backer bringing it forward, and we're supportive of the amendment.
Seeing the author approves, and is there any comments? Representative,
I just want to make sure. I know I just walked in a little bit late, but you mentioned the author. We got Representative Pinto and Representative
Kotyza-Witthuhn.
Sorry, I've said it correctly other times, but
it's okay.
So, but how are we splitting up the bill? We got two authors, or
we have two. We have two authors and one bill.
Okay. Gotcha. Thanks.
Equal billing.
Equal billing. Okay.
As we'll all use, not all of us, but most of us will use this wonderful bill on our literature about how great we are with children.
Understood.
Okay. Seeing no, is there any other comments? And the author isn't, the authors are in favor. All those in favor of the A11 amendment as amended, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? The A-11 amendment as amended is adopted. We have an A-12 amendment here.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
First,
thank you, Mr. Chair. I would actually move to make an oral amendment to this, delete everything after the and insert the first engrossment.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
As amended.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. this amendment is just a technical clarification. to the one-time appropriation for child care grants through June 30, 2022, like the other appropriations in the rest of the bill are. With this clarification, it seems that the funds would cancel back earlier.
Any comments from the audience? Any comments from the office?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Representative, for bringing this amendment and catching the, that small error. Well, we take it as a friendly amendment.
I have a couple of comments. I have been dealing with deed for a number of years. And I would like to speak to the idea that they may not be able to use $10 million by 22. Is there a reason, or would the authors of the amendment or the bill be amenable to changing that to 23?
We don't have any issue with that, Mr. Chair.
So the chair will move to amend the A12 amendment on line, on page 1, line 3, delete 2022 and insert 2023. Any comments? Anybody from the department care to speak to this? Please identify yourself for the tape and proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members. For the record, my name is Devin Bowdry, Government Relations Coordinator for DEED. And yes, 2023 would be much more useful for us.
Any other comments?
Mr. Chair, I would.
Yes.
Mr. Chair, I would accept this as well.
Thank you. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. All right, to the amendment as amended. All those in favor of the A12 amendment as amended, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. We have an A13. Representative Kosnick.
Mr. Chair, I move to orally amend the A13 amendment. Page 1, line 1, delete everything after the and insert first engrossment comma.
Please proceed. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Please proceed with your amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Members, this amendment requires DEED to submit a report on the legislature to the outcomes of the grant programs. The bill already does require child care grant receipts. Recipients must report to the commissioner the outcomes of the grants program, and this amendment makes sure that the legislature can see those results as well and make informed, better decisions.
Did the authors have any comments?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And Representative Kosnick, we would accept this as a friendly amendment.
Any other comments? Any questions? Seeing none. All those in favor of the A13 amendment as amended, signify by saying aye.
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 Those opposed, same sign. The A13 amendment as amended is passed. We have an A14.
Mr. Chair.
Representative Mecklen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. A14, I would move to orally amend the A14 amendment, page 1, line 1, delete everything after the and insert first engrossment.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. We have the A14 amendment as amended in front of us.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. this amendment clarifies that the Minnesota Initiative Foundation cannot require the child care providers to participate in parent aware in order to receive assistance. As we've all heard numerous times, we have a major lack of daycare for children. All of us have heard from our in-home daycares, our smaller ones, that this is a very cumbersome step, and we were asking that this be accepted as a favorable amendment.
Representative Pinto.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative, thanks for this proposal. We're supportive of the last few amendments, but this one we do have concerns about and would oppose. I'll note there is not a requirement that parent aware be used in the funding, but on the other hand, to impose a requirement on the Minnesota Initiative Foundations that they not use that feels like not an appropriate step. We want to trust the MIFs in terms of the work they do. I should note that the bill contains an evaluation of parent aware. I think all of us would think that we need to make sure to examine how it's working, and so it does contain an evaluation of that, and we'll look at it. But in the meantime, that is the system Minnesota has to make sure that we have quality and early care and learning. And I'd hate to hamstring the MIFs as they're distributing this funding, that if they believe in a certain circumstance that they should require this, I don't know that we should be stepping in and substituting our judgment. So I should note that the MIFs would be opposed to this, and the bill's authors would as well.
Representative Baker.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I guess to either author, I would ask that you reconsider that. What I'm hearing again is that as much as we all like the Parent Aware program, there is not that dispute. However, there's a lot of in-home centers, in-home daycare homes that just can't participate. They really want to keep their costs as low as possible. That is a huge driver in rural Minnesota. It's different than it is, I think, here in the metro. So I would just ask that you do reconsider this acceptable. We can work it as it moves through the process a little bit more, but it's putting it in too much of a one-size-fits-all again. And I'm concerned about that, Representative Pinto, that this, what I thought was very, very, a lot of friendly amendments today. I want to fight a little bit more because, again, I've got friends that are in this business. They're really good at it. They don't do parent aware, and their parents love them. And I just, there's that, we have to stand up for them too. So I would hope that you might want to reconsider that.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative Baker, I certainly get where you're coming from. My concern is that this amendment is a one-size-fits-all amendment. This says you can't do it at all. The experts on Greater Minnesota, Rural Minnesota, to my mind, in terms of this work, are the Minnesota Initiative Foundations. This is the work they do. They're not based in the metro at all. They know their communities, and they have such an incentive to make sure to address the child care crisis happening in Greater Minnesota, as, of course, there's a crisis in the metro as well. So my concern is that we would not want to unduly get in their way and impose a one-size-fits-all solution. Remember, this funding does not necessarily require that parent aware be used, but the amendment would prohibit the MIFs from having that be a part of their funding. And to my mind, we want to give them the flexibility to figure out what's going to fit best for their individual communities.
Mr. Chair, just to follow up, again, maybe I'm reading it wrong. It appears to me that we want to make sure the foundations do not require this as part of the funding. So we can't require the child care providers to participate in Parent Aware in order to receive this assistance. Am I reading that wrong?
Mr. Representative Pinto.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative Baker, I think you sort of are in the sense that if a MIF decided in a given circumstance, we're going to award this funding, but we're going to require this particular provider to use Parent Aware. They may not do it in other situations, but they are in this particular situation. So we're tailoring it to the circumstances. This amendment would block that. So this would be a one-size-fits-all. This says MIFs, no matter what you may think about a particular bit of funding, a particular situation, a particular provider, a particular community, you are prevented. And to my mind, that's just not an appropriate thing for us to be doing. So it is a one-size-fits-all solution in that way.
Representative Robbins.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. To that point, I've had a lot of concerns about the Parent Aware program in my district too. And so in line 21.8 sub 4, your current language says that the MIF should use some of the money to recruit child care programs to participate in Parent Aware and provide targeted resources to encourage high levels of participation. So my friendly suggestion is that if you're not willing to take the amendment, perhaps you would just strike that so that at least you're not using some of this money to increase participation in Parent Aware when there are so many concerns already, and we just get the study and be neutral on Parent Aware.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Well, Representative Robbins, I mean, Parent Aware is the system that we have in our state to ensure quality in early care and learning. Mm-hmm. And so while it's being evaluated, while we make sure, because there's plenty of funding that goes to providers that are not parent aware or rated, that don't have that participation. We want to continue to support that as it's being evaluated. But the fact is, that is the system that our state uses. And so to have part of the funding be available to recruit providers to participate in that and support them as they go. And again, this is the MIFs are given a lot of flexibility in terms of all these points. I guess to my mind, that is in fact the system that our state has to ensure that there's quality in early care and learning. So I guess I'm not sure why we would not want to provide support to recruit providers to do that, so long as we're certainly, again, there's no requirement that funding can only go to providers who participate in that program. But I guess I would have concerns. I do know we have a testifier who's available for question of a parent aware. I know time is limited as well, though, so this may provide sufficient information. But I guess I would have great concerns that we would not, as long as we have this system in place, we want to make sure to continue to be working on it, even as we're evaluating it at the same time.
Thank you.
Representative Kosny.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I know this committee struggles sometimes or tries to find to strike a balance between rural and metro initiatives.
No. Metro always loses.
Well, you'll like what I'm bringing up here then, sir. I was wondering if the author is just kind of looking, you know, at the bottom of page 20 and up to page 21, that this is really talking a lot about rural, and I know that there's a need there, but as a dad that went through quite a bit of child care and struggled to find some affordable care, how does this clause in your bill to either of the authors relate to metro care providers?
Representative Pinto.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Well, and I know we have an amendment that'll be coming that'll talk a little bit about, I believe, from the minority also talking about that balance. It is true that this funding for the Minnesota Initiative Foundations is aimed at Greater Minnesota. I'll point out, as you're well aware, there's a crisis everywhere throughout the state. This is one reason that the deed funding is 50% metro, 50% Greater Minnesota. The First Children's Finance funding is all throughout the state, including the metro. We do have a loss of family care providers in particular. It looks different in Greater Minnesota. We want to make sure to be taking care of families throughout the state. But I'll admit, as a metro legislator, you know, it's I want to make sure that we're dealing with our metro situation as well. But let's just let's keep in mind that we're advancing a proposal here that does a lot to help Greater Minnesota as well.
Mr. Chair.
One more, because we need to be done here in about 15 minutes, so that we have enough time to get everybody the
I appreciate the author's comments. I guess I would just echo the concerns of having to have parent aware, because whether you're outstate or rural Minnesota or in the metro, a lot of the providers struggle with having to comply with a lot of the parent aware and aren't super excited about that program.
Representative Dabney.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And in the interest of time, I'll simply remind members that when ParentAware and the Early Learning Scholarship System was established, the exchange was clear. You get state money for quality child care. And I think that kids in rural Minnesota deserve, and their parents deserve, access to quality child care. Thank you.
Thank you. Representative Mecklen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative Pinto, you just made reference to the lack of available daycare, child care. What do you, in your opinion, has caused that?
Representative Pinto.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you so much for the question. Well, the economics of child care simply don't work. And to be clear, this is all throughout the country, right? This is true throughout the country. If you figure out the cost of caring for four infants, rate of 4-to-1, which I think is a safe rate, we'd hate to have it be a heck of a lot out of balance like that. If you run the numbers for a child care business, it is extremely difficult to make that work. And we know that parents are paying way more than they can afford. They certainly couldn't pay more. Providers couldn't possibly take any less money. And so fundamentally, we know that there needs to be a support for that system, and that's the situation. To be clear, it's not regulations, because this is happening all throughout the country, in red states and blue states and all in between. You've got a situation where over the past bunch of decades, you've got both parents working, you've got many more kids, we know that wages have stagnated, et cetera, and so you're in a situation where families cannot afford the care and learning opportunities, because that's what this is, that they need at a rate that can compensate providers. It just doesn't, the numbers don't add up, and I'm happy to share all sorts of studies and various things for you, with you on that.
Are there any other questions, concerns? All right, we will, the A14 has been moved, as amended, has been moved. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed say no.
No.
No. No.
Does not pass. We have the A15. Who has the A15? Senator Robin.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I move to orally amend the A15 amendment, page one, line one, delete everything after the and insert first engrossment, comma.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Now, we have the A15 as amended. Please present your amendment.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. The bill provides funding to Women Venture to operate a business training program to help new childcare startups in underserved areas become profitable and sustainable. This amendment clarifies that for these startups, the business training should also include a needs analysis to identify whether a family childcare provider or a childcare center would be the best model to serve the needs of the community. This way, potential childcare providers looking to start serving Minnesotans have an idea of which business model will work best in their communities.
Who would like to take that one?
I'll take that one. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Representative Robbins, for bringing this amendment. So last year, I did have two separate funding bills for Women Venture before this committee. One was a cooperative funding model that they had been running in the metro area. We were hoping to create an rural Minnesota, greater Minnesota center to see how that things would move along. And then the separate bill was an online training program. So what remains in House File 1 this year is the online training modules. So I believe that there's 12 segments of this online training, the first of which is really kind of the basics of childcare. So if somebody is considering opening up a childcare business, whether it is a parent who wants to be at home with their own children and knows that there are some other kids in the neighborhood or families in the area that need that service, and they are exploring beginning a childcare, in-home childcare business, or if they are, you know, working to open up a childcare center, it really helps clarify kind of the two different paths that they have options for. We were hopeful to have a kind of a breakdown in your folders today. I don't think we have that, but I can get an electronic copy to all of you later on. Kind of breaks down all the different modules. And so these will be available online all across the state to potential business owners. And we just don't feel like outside of that original module that kind of gives people the basics of the childcare business and the choices that they have, that a needs analysis would really fit within those segments. So we're not going to accept this amendment today.
Any questions? Representative Robbins.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I appreciate that. And in the section subdivision 3, it really doesn't talk about that process at all, the online models. It doesn't specify it's online. So I would say that's at least needs to be cleared up in the language. But I would just, you know, as you're making maybe an effort to do that, I would hope you would consider this, because for people who are really trying to build a business in unserved areas, really understanding what their community needs are and what would be profitable, to your point on the earlier discussion. I mean, to go through all of that and not really have an analysis of what would work in that, you know, particular market, I think is a disservice to the people who are trying to start these businesses. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And that's a point well taken, Representative Robbins. As I am kind of rereading this, it looks like we may have skipped over the online
not in there.
Description. And so if I know we have to deal with this amendment first, but perhaps we could initiate an oral amendment and just include that as long as we're working through it today.
I'm going to give staff fair warning to start looking at it while we do.
I would suggest in line 21.16 between A and business that we add online if possible, but we'll deal with the amendment at hand first.
And does this bill have another stop?
It does, Mr. Chair. So there are several more.
I'm going to somewhat agree with Representative Robbins that we should make it really clear, because a needs assessment for a business, we do a lot of small businesses around here, and a lot of small businesses jump right in, really get excited, and fail. And that's not fair. Please take a look at it. Please talk with some of the people at Deed and how to do this, or who is ever going to provide this, how you can make that needs assessment more accessible, because I think it would be helpful. So why don't you do this and do that in the next committee? Because if you have several to go, you got to find one you can put that in. So with that, I will. We should all keep on the authors to remember to do that. Any other comments on the A15 as amended? Seeing as the author has said that they prefer not to have this on at the present time, all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed say no.
No.
No. Next stop, though, but will somebody be looking? Come on. I guess I didn't say the A15 as amended did not pass. All right, who's got the A16?
Mr. Chair.
Okay, Representative Baker.
Thank you. I'd like to move to orally amend the A16 amendment, page 1, line 1, delete everything after the and insert the first engrossment comma.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, same sign. We have the A16 in front of us, as amended in front of us.
Mr. Chair, thank you. I guess all this is actually doing is it's supporting your testifier, Mr. Penny, who, again, is very supportive of the program, as I am to most of a degree here. But I want to make sure that the best child care operators and really the handholders in rural Minnesota is our initiative foundations. And I just want to make sure that all of them get a piece of this. Doesn't say how much or percentage-wise, not equally, but it's just I want to make sure that every single one around the state of Minnesota has the ability to tap into this. And I certainly hope that you can accept this for rural Minnesota.
To the author.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Representative Baker. So we have spoken with the Minnesota Initiative Foundations. It is their plan that typically these funds are split evenly throughout the different regions across the state of Minnesota. But they also do would appreciate flexibility and not having it included in statute. So we are going to not take this amendment today.
So Mr. Chair, and thank you. So we're trying to clarify the language. We're trying to make sure that they all hit it, and I'm not sure why this simple language, if you're saying, Representative Kotyza-Witthuhn, why this wouldn't then just be accepted and we move on. Otherwise, I think it's a roll call kind of vote for me, because it's making sure that it's going to go to the initiatives.
Before we go there, let me make a couple of comments after 20 years, and I'm sure there's another person on this committee after 20 years could say that I've never heard one of the, even as we hear the rumors of the initiative foundations, have complained about one being a bully and stealing more money than the other. So I've never heard that. Representative Pinto.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And Representative Baker, I guess the thinking is, in your comments for this amendment, you talked about how the MIFs are really the people we look to. They're the ones we trust, et cetera. They're telling us they prefer not to do this. This is their plan, but they are saying they prefer not to. You talked about Mr. Penny's testimony, and he's saying, and the MIFs are saying they prefer not to do this. I think we can trust them to figure out the best plan. I think presumably 99.9% of the time they're doing this, but they'd prefer to have the flexibility, and I think we can trust them to figure out the best way to allocate funds. So we would object, again, in part in consultation with them.
So we're going to go to a vote. On the A16 as amended, the authors have recommended a no vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed?
No.
No.
The A16 as amended failed. A10.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. First of all, move to orally amend the A10, page 1, line 1, delete everything after the and insert first engrossment comma.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
You have the A10 in front of us as amended.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And this committee, the history that I've learned is that we've really done a great job of balancing funds between metro and rural Minnesota, and really appreciate that being a rural member. But as I look at this bill and look at the facts, rural Minnesota is facing a crisis that is, some folks, the data I've seen, 5 times the metro, that we have 36,000 open slots for daycare in greater Minnesota, and the metro may have 6,000. And certainly there's much more availability in the metro for center-based care, and we don't have as many of those institutions or opportunities in rural. So our daycare situation is mainly served by in-home providers, and we've talked a lot about that today and some of those challenges. So I hope you find this as a friendly amendment. I'm just asking to increase the percentage of grants to communities outside the 7-county metro from the 50 to the 60. And again, recognizing that we have really acknowledged that rural need and much of our work in the Jobs Committee in the past. So I hope you consider this as a friendly change.
Briefly, Representative Pinto.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Representative Haley. As Representative Kosnick pointed out before, we've got the Minnesota Initiative Foundation funding is going strictly to Greater Minnesota. We did not talk about this, but we actually have, as part of the Child Care Assistance Program rate setting, we have a single statewide rate for family care, because as you point out, family care is a particular issue for Greater Minnesota. Setting the rates at the metro level, this is something done in some other states. We know that there's a lot of concern about how the rates are set. So, right. In other words, you've got a lot of funding going to Greater Minnesota through family care, through that CCAP rate. I'll be honest, as a metro member, I wondered a little bit about, is having these deed funds even be 50-50, because there is a major crisis in the metro as well. But I'll just point out, there's a lot in this bill already that is really heavily supporting Greater Minnesota. We are happy to do that. But the thought that this deed funding would not be 50-50 and be increased to be that much more to Greater Minnesota, to my mind, just does not acknowledge the fact that this is a crisis everywhere around the country and certainly everywhere in the state, including in the metro. So we are opposed to your amendment with respect.
Mr. Chair, one follow-up?
Certainly.
To the authors, was my statistic, is that correct, 36,000 open slots in rural Minnesota compared to 6,000 in the metro?
Representative Pinto.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And Representative Haley, I'm not sure if those numbers are correct. I'll say that they don't. That doesn't seem quite right to me, but I obviously don't have it in front of me. And if you have something that you're looking to, I don't know. But I will say that there is a huge crisis in the metro. If we simply looked at the metro, you would say there is a screaming crisis for parents and children in the metro. And there may be even bigger crisis in Greater Minnesota, but there's a crisis everywhere in our state. And with the funds we have going to Greater Minnesota in this bill, strictly to Greater Minnesota, we are absolutely supporting those families and communities. But we also need to do that in the metro as well. So 50-50 feels appropriate to me for this particular portion of the bill.
Representative Backer.
Thank you, Chair. And I appreciate where you're coming from there, Representative Pinto, though I think our first testifier, who's from Fergus Falls West Central Initiative Fund, which serves my area, would agree that we have less resources in Greater Minnesota. So if you're screaming in the metro area, than we're blasting in the rural area, okay? And I appreciate you. You and I have worked on other things, and you tried to be fair. But I think this amendment is the 60 going to greater Minnesota. I just know what's in Traverse County, in Wilkin County, in Big Stone County. I've been working with the issue in Clinton, Minnesota. We just don't have the facilities for our center care. And so we really need those additional resources, because right now we're losing the fight with North Dakota and South Dakota. What I call our makers, who are the risk takers, who are the small business owners, they're going to the Fargo area, not the Moorhead. They're going to the Wahpetons. They're going to the Watertowns, South Dakota, because they have the resources that we do not see in Minnesota. And being a border community, that I live 1 mile away from the border, South Dakota, I see this as an issue. So I would ask for support for just the care of our children in greater Minnesota. I do appreciate that. Thank you.
No, I'm going to answer this particular one because it has been a true irritant underneath my skin for many, many years. We in the metro get blamed for taking everything out of greater Minnesota. Amen. The metro area provides 80% of the revenue for this state. That's where I preach. This committee has never, in my time here, ever not been less than 70 to 75% going to greater Minnesota. Most of the resources from the metro area go to greater Minnesota. My kids, the kids that play on my block, deserve to have the same opportunities as the kids in greater Minnesota. I hope everyone votes no for this particular bill. Is there any other comment on this amendment?
I do.
Representative, go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And actually, if we look at the 50-50 funding, the metro kids are getting less because 60% of the population actually lives in the metro area. And so if you look at it per capita, 50-50 seems, I guess, somewhat fair. But also being a parent who just went through trying to find childcare, it's not easy. It's really expensive. And I live in a pretty densely populated area. I had to get Claire on a waiting list basically the day session was done. I had so when February rolled around, we would have an infant spot for her. And they're infants up until 16 months. So, that 4-to-1 ratio is up until 16 months. And so this is, looking at it, I think 50-50 is more than fair, considering that per capita they're getting less than what they should.
Seeing no other questions, all those in favor of the A-10 amendment, please signify by saying aye.
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 All those opposed?
No.
No.
Oh.
Isn't it nice to have Mahoney unleashed? The A-10 amendment, as amended, fails. We need to get to the next bill. So are there any comments? Are there any comments? Seeing none. What is the motion? Which committee are you going to?
Education, Finance.
All those in favor of...
I may not have exactly the right name. I say that right.
That's close enough.
Close enough. It's Chair Dabney.
All those in favor of moving this bill to the Education, Finance Division, please signify by saying aye.
What? Aye.
Okay. All those opposed? Oh, well, before we get any farther, when the final motion to pass is whoever makes the motion, I will have to add this in, I guess. And we'll see if nonpartisan staff says I'm good. I move that nonpartisan, we're going to, how do I take that back? How do I take that back? Or do I have to? On this bill, we're going to move that the nonpartisan committee staff is authorized to make any technical changes necessary to reflect the will of the committee. And I don't think we have to vote on that. I don't think so. All in favor of that motion signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Now, all those in favor of, I move that we move the, better get back to staff. I move that House File 1 is sent to, is referred to Education Finance.
As amended.
As amended. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. You're on your way. Thank you.
Thank you,
Mr. Chair, members.
Representative Stephenson. Bill, would you care to move your bill?
Mr. Chair, I move that House File 1405 be referred to the Energy and Climate Change Policy and Finance Division.
Please proceed.
I do have an amendment. I don't know if you want me to do that now or. Yeah, so first, I move the A23 amendment. I have an oral amendment as well. I would move to orally amend the A23 amendment, page 1, line 1, delete division, page 1, line 2, delete everything before the comma.
Could you repeat that?
The oral amendment, I would move to orally amend the A23 amendment, page 1, line 1, delete division, page 1, line 2, delete everything before the comma.
The oral amendment. Everyone's heard and written down the oral amendment. Any comments? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign.
Aye.
The oral amendment has it. By a whisker, but I think people haven't had enough coffee to get their voices going this morning.
And then I would, the underlying amendment, Mr. Chair, the A23, make some changes to the prevailing wage language that is already in the bill, and I would ask the committee to adopt it.
All right. Any comments on the A23 amendment? Representative Bacon.
Mr. Chair and Representative Stevenson, by doing this and now defining the prevailing wage as part of this, does that change the fiscal note quite a bit, and has that been updated?
Representative Stevenson.
Mr. Chair, I don't believe it would change the fiscal note. We have a fiscal note with prevailing wage in the bill. I don't believe that this change would change the fiscal note, as the current prevailing wage language had no fiscal impact. So no, I don't believe it would change the fiscal note.
Thank you.
Seeing no other comments, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed?
Aye.
Aye.
The A23 amendment is approved, is amended, as amended, is passed.
All right. Mr. Chair. Sorry.
We have, who has the A24? Do you want to do it now, or you want to wait to an opportune time where you can just, no. Would you care to do it now, or do you want to wait?
We can wait if you'd like.
I always throw it back in my court. All right, let's do that right now and get it over with. Care to move the A24?
Yes, Mr. Chair, I'd like to move the A24. First, I do have an oral amendment to the amendment. Like the previous one, page 1, line 1, delete division, page 1, line 2, delete everything before the comma.
We have the A24 in front of us as amended. Please proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This amendment includes the protections for the proposed Becker natural gas plant, as we heard last week. This is, we have to have something that creates baseload when the wind's not blowing and the sun's not shining. And this is the best way to obviously do this. I'm actually quite amazed that this is even a conversation why we're having it. So I would hope you would find this as a friendly amendment.
Representative Stephenson.
Mr. Chair, I would not find this as a friendly amendment. A few notes. One is that the law that approved this facility is not changed by this bill. It's not repealed or amended. That law would be in effect. Number two, this particular amendment was voted down by the Energy Committee last week. Number three, the amendment is to a section of the bill that's not being considered by this committee, so I'd ask this committee to not add this amendment to the bill.
Any other comments? Any other comments? All in favor of the A24 amendment as amended? I never amended it? Okay, we got to vote on the oral amendment. All in favor of the oral amendment, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those in favor of the A24 as amended, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those, I voted incorrectly. Hopefully there's enough people. All those in favor of the all those opposed to the A24 amendment, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. They need more coffee.
No.
The A24 as amended did not pass. Pardon? All right. All those in favor of the A24 signify by raising your hand. Thank you. All those opposed to the A24 amendment as amended signify by saying by raising your hand. You count?
I didn't count.
It does not pass.
Just want to be sure. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Now we have the bill as amended in front of us.
Mr. Chair, the clean energy revolution is well underway, and while the revolution was initially sparked and guided by policy like OSA's Next Generation Energy Act, today's primary driver is economics. The price of wind and solar are low and dropping. In fact, the price of solar is dropping by over 1% a month. That's over 20% a year. That causes a lot of disruption to our energy markets. We are fortunate in Minnesota to have a number of good corporate citizens operating in the energy space, including Xcel, cooperations like Nexus, 3M, Best Buy, all doing good work and encouraging a switch to clean energy. That transition, though, has a number of impacts on our economy and our society. This bill is an attempt to smooth and speed that transition. It is before this committee for two principal reasons. The first relates to prevailing wage, as I already mentioned, is an important part of this bill. We want to make sure that next generation of energy infrastructure is built by good-paying jobs that can support families, just like the last generation of energy infrastructure in Minnesota was built with those jobs. The second reason why the bill is before the committee are a number of provisions that encourage the PUC to take into account the impact on local jobs and making its decisions about which resources to build, and I think those provisions are also very important to make sure that our economy continues to function at a high level in the energy space. I do want to note that the bill, we have a preliminary fiscal note. The reason why it's preliminary is because nonpartisan staff is still reviewing, and the Legislative Budget Office is reviewing the commerce note on the bill. That accounts that the Commerce Department we're looking at is under the purview of the Energy Committee. So the fiscal note as it relates to Dolly Indeed is final, the departments that this committee is concerned with. There is a fiscal impact to Deed, but by agreement of the chairs, that's going to be taken care of out of the Energy Committee as well. So there's no request before this committee for any general fund to support this bill. And with that, Mr. Chair, I would turn over to my testifier.
Good morning. Please identify yourself for the tape and proceed.
Good morning, Chair Mahoney. My name is Kevin Prannis, and I'm here today on behalf of Liuna, Minnesota, North Dakota, a union of more than 12,000 construction laborers who build and maintain our state's transportation, water, energy, and building infrastructure, together with building trades, brothers and sisters. And I want to thank the chair and the committee for the opportunity to testify in favor of House File 1405. We're here today because we believe, for our members, the Clean Energy First bill is all about jobs and economic development. In addition to providing affordable, safe, and reliable service, our electric utilities have provided high-quality career opportunities for thousands of Minnesotans, including our members and building trades, other building trades members. The energy landscape is changing, as Representative Stephenson's mentioned, and those changes are affecting our members and their communities. And our promise to them is that we'll fight to make sure the jobs in clean energy are as good and as available to local workers as the jobs have been for previous generations in conventional and nuclear energy. Unfortunately, that promise hasn't always been a reality. Over the past decade, as wind and solar boomed, we saw more reliance on use of out-of-state labor and low-wage temporary workers to build wind and solar generation. In 2018, we asked North Star Policy Institute to help us investigate the problem and discover that Minnesota communities were losing hundreds of high-quality job opportunities and tens of millions of dollars in economic activity because the industry had failed to prioritize jobs for local workers. Since then, we've been working together with state and local building trades councils and unions that build wind energy to insist that these projects create good jobs for local workers. We've made progress with the help of many allies, and a growing number of utilities and clean energy developers have stepped up to the plate, taking steps to prioritize local hiring on renewable energy projects and creating hundreds of job opportunities that wouldn't otherwise have existed. Despite these efforts, the realities are stark. Between 2012 and 2020, we estimate that the outsourcing of construction labor on clean energy projects cost local workers some 2,000 jobs and erased more than $100 million in potential economic benefits, with the greatest losses occurring, and I hesitate to say this, in greater Minnesota. During this period, we saw a half dozen projects built in the pipeline in Minnesota and nearly a dozen in neighboring states, but with overwhelmingly non-local workforce. And who paid for those projects? For the most part, it was Minnesota Electric customers. Until the legislature acts, this problem will continue. If we want a successful transition, we can't leave Minnesota's skilled energy workforce behind. Clean Energy First takes the challenge head on by requiring regulators and utilities to consider and prioritize local workers in the resource planning and selection process. The goal to make sure that Minnesotans, utility ratepayers, and local workers who live in commuting distance of a project aren't shut out because a big national wind and solar contractors would rather bring in crews from Texas or Tennessee. The same considerations given in the process in this bill to mining jobs, which are critical to northern Minnesota. If a utility can bring forward a resource plan that results, for example, in wind energy facilities using more Minnesota iron, that's a win for all of us. I'd be happy to answer specific questions about how the preference would work in practice. The other important piece here is the establishment of prevailing wage requirements for large energy projects, which would encourage the use of local workers and contractors and guarantee a ready supply of skilled labor to meet Minnesota's growing infrastructure needs. Responsible developers and contractors in this space already pay prevailing wage rates. The proposed requirement would help to ensure they can do so without being undercut by others that are more likely to cut corners when it comes to quality, safety, and fair treatment of workers, including racial and ethnic pay disparities that we have seen in projects that where prevailing wage was not paid. Regarding safety, I want to point out a couple of months ago in Washington State, a 24-year-old temporary worker was buried alive trying to rescue a coworker from a trench collapse on a wind energy project. Prevailing wage requirements would minimize the risk that such tragedy occurs in Minnesota. Finally, on the energy side, the bill's been carefully crafted to avoid negative impacts on jobs and economic development by focusing on new resources and requiring that plans approved by the commission are affordable and reliable. Finally, as we express our support for House File 1405, we'd be remiss not to point out work that's been done in the Senate that's important. First, in the area of utility ownership, where we believe a significant level of utility ownership of clean energy assets provides greater public control, transparency, and assurance that it'll be operated safely and respecting the needs of workers and communities. And in fact, as the recent report found, could increase diversity. And then the work that on the Senate to address concerns of iron mines we think is important and should be considered because those are businesses highly exposed to energy rates, and it's important that we keep those affordable. Thank you.
Thank you. Do you have any other testifiers?
I don't believe that I have any further testifiers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We have 25 minutes, so I'm going to do 10 to 15 minutes to testify, and then we're going to have questions and comments from the committee, and then we're going to vote. So those who would like to testify, please come on down. Looks like I got four people right now. So you each got about 2.5 minutes. Go ahead.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, I'm Rick Evans, and this is a big bill we've been working on in the Energy Committee. I'm not going to comment on all of it. I just would like to make note, we are, XL Energy is sympathetic with leveling the playing field with respect to prevailing wage. We are in sync with the trade unions on that. We do think that the language that was put in the bill today is problematic in accomplishing that goal. We've talked with the author, and he's agreed to work with us. And when we get back to the Energy Committee, we'll work with the trade unions and the author and fix that. I'm confident, but I just did want to put on the record that we do think that provision that was added today needs a little work.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, members, my name is Kelsey Johnson. I'm the president of the Iron Mining Association. The Iron Mining Association represents 6 active iron mines and 200 vendor member businesses that supply goods and services to the mines. Collectively, the direct and indirect jobs impact is 16,000. We remain the largest industry in Northeast Minnesota after 135 years of supplying America with its iron. The economic health of the iron mining industry and the jobs that we provide depend on our ability to maintain a globally competitive position in the iron and steel markets. The competitive position of our industry is highly influenced by the cost of electric power. Energy is the single biggest cost of iron ore pellet production after labor costs and represents approximately 25% of the cost of processing iron ore. Since 2007, the mine's electric rates have increased by approximately 65%. While the mines support investments to advance cleaner electric generation, we need to ensure that the cost of those investments do not place us in an uncompetitive position. We are concerned that as drafted, House File 1405 does not contain key provisions that will mitigate unsustainable cost increases and maintain energy rates that support jobs in Minnesota. The Senate companion to Clean Energy First includes a few provisions that affect jobs. First, the Senate version provides customers of Minnesota Power assurances that the Boswell Energy Center would continue to operate as long as it is in the public interest and has a positive net book value. If Boswell were to retire early, the mines and other ratepayers would be required to pay for the facility but not benefit from this facility and pay for replacement generation and transmission. Second, the Senate provision also has a provision that would direct the Public Utilities Commission to set electric rates based on the cost of service. For large industrial customers, this could keep electric rates competitive because the mines take a large load that requires proportionately less infrastructure and overhead to serve. Electric rates have a significant impact on the competitiveness of Minnesota's iron ore mines because the large amount of power that is required to produce pellets. Maintaining the competitiveness of the mines is critical to maintaining the thousands of jobs they support directly and indirectly. While we do not oppose the goals of Clean Energy First, we believe important cost containment provisions need to be included in order to maintain the competitiveness of the iron mining industry.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Please identify yourself for the tape and proceed.
Thank you. Mr. Chair and members, my name is Shane Zard. I'm with Flaherty and Hood and represent the Coalition of Utility Cities. And the Coalition of Utility Cities is a group made up of the 8 cities in Minnesota that host the state's largest power plants. For each of these communities, the plants alone account for anywhere from 40 to up to 70% of the local tax base, have significant impact on county and school district tax base as well. On behalf of those communities, I want to specifically testify on language in the bill and thank the author for including the host community and worker transition planning language that's in the bill. You know, as these communities head toward retirement of these plants, they'll face significant economic development, land use, and planning challenges. And the language in this bill and the interagency coordination that's called for is essential, and it's a good start. I think that these communities and workers will also need some significant investments and other partnership from the state. One proposal that the cities have also supported is Representative Christensen's House File 1919, which is a grant program concept to provide some economic development grants to help out with this type of work. To conclude, I'll also draw your attention when you have more than 2.5 minutes to a report put out by the Center for Energy and Environment released just last month detailing some of the impacts on tax base, some local perspectives for five of the host communities. Also contains a section with perspectives from the Prairie Island Indian community, and a section that with some input from some of the trade unions that will be impacted by this transition. So it's over 100 pages, but worth the read, and I'll thank the committee for your time here.
And, sir, I can't remember whether it was you or some of your partners who were in my office, I will make this suggestion. You should find somebody that has economic development professionalism to put your program together before you bring it back to this committee. Because even if I'm not here and that bill, that comes up, I will come back here to testify against it. You have a lot of work to do on that. Those communities need help, but that's not the plan. Thank you.
Mr. Chair and members, my name is Adam Hansen. I'm with the Associated Builders and Contractors of Minnesota and North Dakota. We represent 350 construction companies and related firms who build our state's renewable energy infrastructure, among other things. Our contractor members are scattered throughout the state, and they build these projects, including some in Granite Falls. One of our contractors is a nationwide wind developer and contractor who's built some in Representative Gunther and Representative Backer's district. Another one of our members is the state's leading installer of solar. They're in Representative Haley's district, and they're ranked 24th in the nation in terms of megawatts installed. So our contractors are already doing this work without the prevailing wage mandates and other regulatory hurdles that are included in this amendment in the bill. The amendment would make developing these clean energy, these wind, these solar, and utility scale projects a regulatory boondoggle. They would drive up costs. And they could lead to developers moving these projects simply several miles to the nearest bordering state in many instances. And that's not good for Minnesota workers, companies, or ratepayers. The amendment requires state-set prevailing wage rates paid on any construction project, regardless if it receives state funding or not, simply if it needs approval by the PUC. This would be unprecedented, and I'm going to say that a few times. Unprecedented for the state to be mandating prevailing wage rates be paid on completely private construction projects. With prevailing wage laws, the state of Minnesota and the Department of Labor and Industry continue to rely on a decades-old survey process and a calculation method to determine what each of those prevailing wage rates in the counties for each trade. In a 2017 study, the Minnesota Center for Fiscal Excellence determined that 72% of all prevailing wage rates in the state at that time were either imported from a neighboring county using old data or a combination of the two. Because of the flawed wage survey process and that calculation, we often see prevailing wage rates that are higher than what the actual market dictates and reflects in that area. This is one of the reasons why advocates of affordable housing and rural broadband frequently come to the legislature asking for exemptions from prevailing wage mandates so they can build more housing, get that last mile of rural broadband in their districts. Again, I'll reiterate, this is unprecedented to mandate prevailing wage laws on private construction work. I'll have you turn your attention to line 1.8 of the amendment that we just adopted. References State Statute 17730, which is a record-keeping and reporting requirement that normally only applies to state-funded projects. Under the amendment, contractors would have to turn over certified payroll records every 2 weeks to the project owner and have, quote, other information turned over or other information the Commissioner of Labor and Industry finds necessary and appropriate readily available to turn over to the Department of DLI and their investigators without cause, without an ongoing investigation, a dispute, or the like. Oh, and those contractor records have to be kept for 3 years after the final payment is made. So ongoing record keeping, ongoing reporting on private construction projects. It's unprecedented, Mr. Chair. Prevailing wage rates also don't guarantee that those projects will be performed using local workers, as advocates have claimed and we heard earlier, or that the project will be completed safely or to a higher quality. Again, I'll refer you to the countless projects that our members are building without issue now throughout the state in your districts. I'd strongly urge this committee and the body to reconsider mandating prevailing wage on these private construction projects. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Please identify yourself for the tape.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. My name is Mike Berkland, and I'm here representing the folks who work in the woods and the folks who work in the mills in northern Minnesota, Minnesota's forest products industries and the Minnesota timber producers. And we, too, are concerned with this bill for the reasons that my colleague from the Iron Mining Association outlined. You know, really, at what cost, at what risk, and at what expense to existing jobs for large power users, for large job providers in northern Minnesota. At the pace of change here is at an accelerated pace that will bring on expense for additional assets that will have to be built, whether it be transmission, whether it be renewable energy sources. We've seen in this state since 2007, the Next Gen Act, investments already made, and we're already exceeding goals for renewable energy mandates that were set at that time. So the story's a good one. We've got good news when it comes to the inclusion and the adoption of renewable energy. So again, I would just bring it back to at what cost, at what risk, and at what expense? Because for our folks in energy-intensive industries who compete on a global and a national scale, those mills are competing for capital dollars, whether it be with their sister mills in, across the country or with other mills across the globe. So it puts our industry at significant competitive disadvantages. We've seen rates increase in Minnesota by 86% electric rates since 2002, and we've lost 2,300 jobs in our industry since that time as well. So great concerns. I guess you know, maybe the best way to put it is we're really concerned about the fact that for the folks who work in the mills, we'd like to see them be able to go home each and every day and be able to pay their electric bills because their job provider can provide them that opportunity. Thank you.
Identify yourself for the tape and please proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members of the committee. I'm Adam Dunnick with the North Central States Regional Council of Carpenters Union. I wanted to just say a couple words in support of Kevin Prentice's comments. I also want to thank Mr. Evans for his testimony and his response. He represents a great employer that our contractors and members do work for every day. I want to make two quick points about prevailing wage and the importance of it. One is on workforce development and retention. When it comes to attracting people into the construction industry, those wages are the number one attraction. We hear about workforce shortages all over the place right now. We are not experiencing that in the billing trades. We have wait lists to get into our apprenticeship programs. So I can't express to you enough how important those wages are in order to attract and retain the best workforce that we have in Minnesota and keep that construction industry strong. Right now we have over 1,400 apprentices in Minnesota alone, over 2,600 across our regional council in six states. Secondly, I just want to talk about how strong our apprenticeship programs are in our industry. And just to verify that, take a look at the industry-recognized apprenticeship program ruling, the IRAP ruling out of the federal DOL that came yesterday. When President Trump's own DOL said the construction industry's apprenticeship programs are the strongest around. We should model other industries' apprenticeship programs like them. They're not taxpayer funded. They're very strong in terms of standards and professionalism and safety, and we ought to model our apprenticeship programs after them. So having language around prevailing wage is going to support those apprenticeship programs, and that's what I want to testify to that effect today. Thank you for your time.
Are there any other comments? Any other comments?
Oh, I'm on their left.
Representative Backer.
Yeah, first of all, I do ask for a roll call when we do take this up for a vote. Two questions. Well, the first one deals with jobs and so forth. When I go through this and others have, what it looks to me by including reference to mining and the definitions of local workers and local, it will affect local mining jobs. It appears that the goal of this bill is to end mining operation in the state. So my first question deals with is, how many workers will this bill put out on jobs? How many jobs will be lost with this bill?
Briefly, do you have a number?
Mr. Chair, I don't know that I have a number. I disagree with the premise of the question in a couple different ways. I'll be very brief to say that I think it's the exact opposite of what was the representative just said. By referencing mining in the jobs, we are prioritizing the mining industry as we know it's very important. We're not That's just a misstatement of what the bill says and what the bill does.
I would professionally disagree with you. It's not a misstatement. It's how you interpret it, and we need to protect. When we increase the cost of electricity, we are going to decrease mining and so forth. That is that. So that is just simple economics. As a business owner, if you increase the cost of input, you're going to have to decrease something. So when we increase electricity costs on to the businesses, if it's a small business or a big business like mining, you're going to lose jobs. So I would professionally disagree with you there, Representative.
And Mr. Chair, I just want to note that that's the opposite. The argument that the representative made a minute ago was that because we referenced local mining jobs in the local job impacts definition, that we were going to be targeting mining for ending. That's what I said was a misrepresentation. And now the argument is that we're going to increase electricity costs, which will target mining jobs. When in fact, wind and solar are the cheapest forms of energy available now, and as I referenced, are dropping. This bill will be good for jobs across the state. That's my comment.
The committee's in recess. And the DFL will caucus up on...